All right, so good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to lecture 31, Quantum Mechanics Part 1. In the previous lecture, we discussed finite potential well, right? So what we find is that a finite potential well can have two kinds of states, free states and bound states. So free states are those whose energy is greater than the potential, and bound states are those whose energy is less than the potential, right? So in terms of the classical picture, free states are those which are not affected by the potential, right? And bound states are those which are confined within the region where the potential is non-zero. So once again, the method of solution is simple. You take your region, your potential, and your potential is piecewise continuous, right? So this kind of a potential, where you have it's continuous but in pieces, right? So that means something like this. This is called piecewise continuous. So you consider that these three regions, write down the Schrodinger equation and solve it for these three regions. And for region 1 and 3, you get an increasing exponential and a decreasing exponential respectively. In region 2, you get a sinusoidal solution. Then what remains to be done is to match boundary conditions. So what are the boundary conditions? Boundary condition is that the wave function has to be both differentiable and continuous everywhere, right? Because it's a second order differential equation. So psi of x and psi prime of x both have to be continuous. And if psi prime of x is continuous, then that means that the derivative of psi exists everywhere, and so we call that a differentiable function. In somewhat more technical language, it's known as C1. C1 means that it is differentiable once. So CK would mean, for instance, that the kth derivative exists, okay? Now, so when we look at our boundary conditions, right, there are 2 points, minus L by 2 and plus L by 2. And at these 2 points, we consider both the derivative and the state itself. We we look at, now the thing is that there are two kinds of solutions. One is has even parity, one has odd parity. It's analogous to what happens in the infinite potential well, right? When you put the infinite potential well in this region between minus L by 2 and plus L by 2, your wave functions take the form of cosine, sine, cosine, sine, right? So the cosine functions are even parity, and sine functions are odd parity. So same thing will happen here in the region between minus L by 2 and L by 2. And so from that, what we can determine is that, so if you look at the symmetric solutions, you get that the coefficient B is zero, otherwise the coefficient A is zero, right? This allows us to make the system a little bit easier to solve, and we get one set of boundary conditions. Then applying the continuity of the first derivative, we get the second set of boundary conditions, but then they turn out to be equivalent to each other. So we have these two conditions, we divide one by the other, and we are left with this expression, which is a nonlinear transcendental equation for k. K is the momentum. Okay? So it cannot be solved analytically, you have to solve it numerically or approximately using some method. So one of those is a graphical method, and we define some dimensionless variables. And when we do that, what we find is that the expression can be written this way, where this is the equation of a circle, and this is an equation which we can plot. So when the radius of the circle intersects these lines, you get a solution, and the number of places where they intersect determines the number of bound states. Okay, so you have number of bound states depends on this radius, which is the dimensionless parameter, and it is this quantity, right? So if it is less than n pi by, and I think I might have made a mistake. I think this is pi by 2. And then, right, so this was a mistake here. This will be 3 pi by 2. And this will be 5 pi by 2. That's my error. So if you get, because that is where the tan function, that's how the tan function behaves, right? So if you have n minus 1, and this will be n plus 1 pi by 2. Okay. Where n is an even number in this case. So again, I mean, it's the same logic that we had. It's just the interval is changed a little bit. Are there any questions? Okay, so if you have any questions, you please feel free to unmute yourself and ask, okay? So today we are going to talk about tunneling, and tunneling is one of the most important and applications of quantum mechanics. So what is this phenomenon? It basically means that, let's say that you have some potential which looks like this, or actually let me, okay. So this is an inverted potential well, right? So it's a potential peak or potential hill, if you want to call it. And if you had a classical particle with some energy E, and let's say the height of this potential is V naught, and if E was less than V naught, then what would happen to the particle? The particle would come here, and then it would go up to some height, but then it would come roll back down, right? This is when E is less than V naught. What happens when E is greater than V naught? When E is greater than V naught, the particle can successfully go up the hill and over to the other side, right? So when E is greater than V naught, the particle can go up the hill. When it reaches the top of the hill, it will lose an amount of energy, which is given by V naught, and its remaining energy will be E minus V naught. And then it can roll down back this way, right? So it can go over the hill, right? So this is not anything too difficult to understand, I think. So this is what a classical particle does, right? Right. But what we find in quantum mechanics is that even if E is less than V naught, right? So classically, if the particle cannot go through that potential, if it is a quantum mechanical particle or a wave, there is a finite probability that it can in fact go through and emerge on the other side. Okay, so if it's a quantum mechanical particle, then even if E is less than V naught, what can happen is that now we'll represent it as a wave. This wave comes over here. It reaches the potential. When it reaches the potential, it decays, its amplitude decays. And when it comes out over here, its amplitude is reduced compared to what it was here, but it's still non-zero. Okay. So once again, we'll write this as region 1, 2, and 3. So we'll have psi 1 of x psi 2 of x and psi 3 of x, right? Now, what is the probability to find the particle in any given interval x naught plus delta x, right? Probability of finding particle between x naught and x naught plus dx, right? And it doesn't matter what the potential is. If you know what the state is, this is your state, right? You evaluate it at x naught, and then you multiply by dx, right? So this is your probability of finding the particle between x naught and x naught plus dx, or perhaps in a slightly clearer notation, if you have any two points on the x-axis, then the probability of finding the particle between those two locations is given by this expression, right? It's the, you take psi of x squared at each point and add it up only between those two regions, A and B, right? So here what happens is in this situation is that the amplitude of, is there a question? Please ask me if there's any questions. The amplitude of psi 1x squared is greater than the amplitude of psi 3x squared, right? Because as I've said, in this region where the potential is non-zero, there, what is the solution of the Schrodinger equation? It's just a decaying exponential. Right? So what this means is that the probability of finding the particle to the left of the barrier is going to be greater than the probability of finding the particle to the right of the barrier. Right? And the question is, by what amount? Okay, so we want to figure that out. And again, so now there is one important aspect which is very often neglected in this discussion. It is that we should, if we are thinking of this as a dynamic process, right? So if you have a dynamic process, then what happens is you don't have such kinds of standing solutions, right? So if you have a dynamic process, you have a wave that is incoming. Okay. And it has some momentum K in for incoming, I guess. And then what will happen is it will reflect off the boundary, right? And will go back out. Oh, that's horrible. Better. And let's call that K reflected. But some amount of this wave will pass through the boundary, and we'll call that the transmitted portion, right? And we'll say it has some momentum, KT, T for transmitted, R for reflected, T for transmitted, right? So there is a very nice and simple analogy in terms of classical optics. Right? In classical optics, you say that you have a lens or a mirror or some piece of partially transmitting material, right? You'll send in a ray of light. This is incident. What will happen? Some portion of this light will be reflected, and the remaining portion will be transmitted. Right? Now, how do you describe how there should be some sort of a conservation law, right? Meaning the sum of the reflected and transmitted portions should equal the incident portion, incident light, right? So what should be the quantity that we associate? Well, we should look at the intensity, right? So the intensity, if we say that the intensity of the incident light should be equal to the intensity of the reflected light plus the intensity of the transmitted light, right? So intensity is a measure of, what is intensity a measure of? Can somebody tell me? Drishika, what does light intensity measure? What are the units of light intensity?
Energy, it's amplitude square, right?
It's power.
Okay, power, right, yeah.
Amplitude square, right? It's the amount of energy flux through a given surface. So it's energy per unit time per meter square, right? So if you imagine that the incident light contains n photons per unit time, so then you would have that the number of photons per unit time in the incident light is equal to the number of photons, again, per unit time in the transmitted and reflected waves, respectively, right? Where here n is equal to number of photons per unit time, right? Of course, here I'm assuming that that the energy of photons is the same for all three. For all three of these rays or beams or whatever you want to call it. Okay. So this is essentially what is happening in the quantum mechanical case. You have some particle that is coming in, right? What is the intensity? The intensity is the probability. There's some probability that the particle is going to the left and to the right. These two probabilities should add together to give you this probability, right? But of course, if you want to do a full and proper solution, you should do you should write this as a dynamical state. So you should write this as a wave, which is a function of time also. And but then that becomes much too complicated to solve, right? So the assumption that we make is that all of this can be modeled with something that is time independent, right? So what does that mean if we say that something is such a picture is time independent, right? So if you again imagine that you have a situation like this, you start your incident light source, you turn it on, right? It takes some time for the first photon to hit the lens and then to be reflected or transmitted. But then very quickly what happens is a steady state is established, right? You have a steady beam of photons coming in, being reflected and being transmitted, right? So that steady state is what we are modeling when we look at the quantum mechanical solution of our system, right? So we have some incident particle, but that incident particle is described by a not by a time dependent state, but by a time independent state. So, you know, one might argue that, well, in what sense is it incident if it's time independent, right? Because if it's time independent, then you can't really say that it's moving one way or the other. But you can understand it if you think of it as a steady state solution. Okay. Now, again, what are the Schrodinger equations? We have three Schrodinger equations, right? And again, they are very easy to write down. Plus, what is the potential in region one? The potential is zero. So you just get E psi 1x. And then in region two, this is region one. In region two, you get minus h bar squared by 2m. Psi 2x plus V naught psi 2x is equal to E psi 2x. Okay, and in region 3, we get this same expression only with the this being psi 3x, right? And now what we will say is that this is equal to x is equal to 0, this is x is equal to L. So this is in the region when x is less than 0, This is in the region when x is between 0 and L, and this is in the region when x is greater than L. Here I can put an equality sign. So once again, we get the continuity, right? How do we, continuity and differentiability of the state is what we are going to impose. So first, let's write down the solution of these states in the two regions. You'll get a to the ikx, b to the minus ikx. Then psi 3x is equal to f e to the ikx plus let's say g e to the minus ikx, right? And what happens in between these two regions? In between these two regions, you will get psi 2x. Here, what will you have? You will have two possibilities, right? C e to the k prime x, d e to the minus k prime x. So here, what is k? K is equal to root of 2m e by h bar squared. And here, k prime is root of 2m v naught minus e by h bar squared, right? Is this clear? Is everybody following? If there are any questions or doubts, you please ask. Okay. So once again, there are two possibilities in region two, right? Either an increasing exponential or a decaying exponential. And one might argue that, well, in this case, both those possibilities are allowed, because whether I put a decreasing exponential or an increasing exponential, it doesn't matter because, well, the state will still be normalizable, right? Because this, it is only in this region. But the boundary condition will allow us only one possibility, right? Because the boundary condition has to match. And so, like I said earlier, what you will have is that this thing, the amplitude of psi 1 will be greater than the amplitude of psi 3, right? So the possibility that we are left with is the decaying exponential, right? So this we can set to 0. Okay, so this we can do with the knowledge that the incoming state, right, this is the incoming, and this is the incoming plus transmitted, by the way. And the psi 3 part is the reflected. Okay. All right. So now what we want to do, we want to write down the, compare these boundary conditions, right? So what are the boundary conditions? We must have that psi 1 of x at x is equal to 0 equal to psi 2 of x, x is equal to 0 right? And we'll have the same expression for the derivatives. So I can just put prime over here, prime, prime, prime. Prime means first derivative. Okay. Now, let's see. So what is the right. So now here in the first region, remember I'm saying that this is the incoming wave plus the transmitted wave, right? So how can you see that in this expression? Well, in this expression, you have two components. You have this component, right? So one of these components represents a wave propagating to the right, and the other component represents a wave propagating to the left, right? So A to the EIKX, we will identify as our incident wave. This as our reflected wave. And then we have a transmitted wave. So again, on the other side, we have a transmitted wave, but there is no wave that is coming in from the right-hand side. So the coefficient G in the third region should also be zero. Right? So you will have F e to the IKX is the transmitted wave. And G e to the minus IKX is zero because there is no incoming wave from the right side. Okay. So now we can, and in this side two, we have D e to the k prime x. This is the portion which tunnels. This is a tunneling component. So there should be a minus sign over here, minus k prime x is equal to zero because amplitude of reflected part is going to be less than the amplitude of the incident or incoming part plus the amplitude of the transmitted part, my mistake. Plus the reflected part. Okay. All right. And now so we will, so when we say amplitude, what do we mean? We mean these coefficients, right? A, B, F. So A is the incident amplitude. B is the reflected amplitude. F is the transmitted amplitude, right? And we define the transmission probability as being the ratio of the wave function which is transmitted, so psi 3x, the amplitude of this squared, divided by the amplitude of the incident part. Okay, so let me again be very careful. Instead of writing psi 3, I'll write psi t. T refers to transmitted, and then psi I, so that looks very much like one. So I'll write psi in x. Okay, so this is psi in x. This is psi r x. This is psi t. This is the transmission probability. And similarly, you will have a reflection probability. Which is going to be what? Psi rx squared over psi nx squared, right? So we'll just call this t, we'll just call it r. And what should be the condition? That t plus r should be equal to 1, right? Or t plus r should be equal to the incident amplitude, which is psi nx. X squared. Okay. No, sorry, it will be 1. My mistake. T plus R has to be 1. Which implies that psi Tx amplitude squared plus psi R amplitude squared is equal to psi in amplitude squared. Okay. And how can we determine the values between the relationship between these amplitudes explicitly? See, all of this so far, I have not like actually done any calculation. This is all just physical reasoning. I'm saying that, well, if something is transmitted or it's a part that's reflected, then of course the transmitted plus the reflected part should be equal. But we should be able to derive all of these statements from our boundary conditions, right? So we haven't really applied a boundary condition yet. So let's do that. So let's apply the boundary condition that psi 1x is equal to psi 2x at x equal to 0. This is our first boundary condition. So what is psi 1x? Psi 1x is this object, right? So you get a plus b is equal to f, right? Because we already argued that g should be 0. And similarly, you have psi 2x at x is equal to l is equal to psi 3x equal to L, right? So once again, what would you have? You would have, if you take C to be non-zero, let's say, you would get C plus D is equal to F. But since we just have D, we just get F is equal to D, right? You put X is equal to, oh, sorry, no, my mistake. Let me be a little bit more careful. We get D e to the I, no, not e to the I, my mistake again, minus K prime L is equal to this F e to the I K L. Okay. Now, and this is again wrong, this should be D. All right, so what is the solution? Well, you can sit down and solve it, all of this. Well, but you don't have enough equations there, right? Because how many unknown quantities do you have? You have A, B, D, and F. You have 4 unknown quantities. And how many equations do you have? You have 2 equations. So you need at least 2 more equations in order to be able to solve anything, right? Those 2 equations will come from the differentiability, right? So the derivative of this will give you, so what will be the derivative? You will get ik so this has to be equal to psi 2 prime, the derivative at x is equal to 0, ik into a minus b. What's the derivative of this guy? This guy derivative is minus k prime, is equal to minus k prime d. And then the derivative on the other side . This will give you, if you take the derivative, you'll get the same thing, but now you'll get e to the ikl and e to the minus ikl. So you'll get we're talking about region 2 and 3, right? So in region 2, you'll get e to the minus kappa prime l. And you have to take the derivative, so you'll get a minus kappa prime down, then a d, then minus kappa prime, k prime l, and then in region 3 you have ik, so you get ik f e to the ik. Okay, so this is these are another set of two equations, right? So now we have four equations overall. We have this equation, these two equations. Let me put them. How should I do that? And then you have these two equations. Okay. All right. So now we can solve this equation, and the solution is not so straightforward also. Okay. So I will continue with this, with the solution of this in our next class. So in lecture 30. Okay. I did think about leaving this as a homework problem for you, but then I thought that might not be, some of you might find that to be too difficult. So, okay. So conceptually, there is not much that we have done here, okay? We have just looked at the Schrodinger equation and with certain boundary conditions and applied those boundary conditions. The only conceptual steps really we have taken were in setting these coefficients to zero, right? So, yeah. And now we have to solve these equations, right? So there are four unknowns, A, B, D, and F, and four equations. But of course, do we really have four unknowns? We in fact only have three unknowns, right? Because there will be a normalization requirement which will fix the overall amplitude of the state. Right. Okay. So I'll stop here for the day. See if you have any questions. No questions? Okay. All right. Then I'll see you all on Monday. Okay.